Good morning. Good morning and a very warm welcome to our morning service here at Christchurch. Can I encourage those who haven't yet grabbed a seat to go and find somewhere to sit and make themselves comfortable as we start our time together. Well, whoever you are and wherever you are from and whatever your background, you're really welcome here amongst us. My name is Philip and I'm the vicar here. Well, the thing that we are considering together this morning is this, is the return of the Lord Jesus. Here are some words from the lips of Jesus about his return. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Well, please stand for our first song.
Oh,
take a seat. Well, that last verse that we've just sung reminds us of the future, that Jesus is coming back as Lord in glory. But often we live as if he isn't Lord and isn't coming back. And so we're going to recognize that now in a time of confession. Let's pause, and then I'll lead us. And if you'd like to join in with the words in white on the screen. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love and obedience to God by confessing our sins in repentance and faith. Together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and peace now and forever. Amen. And as those forgiven, we can access our Heavenly Father in prayer and pray to our Heavenly Father. We're going to do that now with the Lord's Prayer. And if you know this prayer in another language, and that is your first language, please feel free to pray this in that other language. Together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, if you'd like to look up, Jesus is coming back, and he is coming back to bring ultimate salvation. Who could save themselves for that day? Well, please stand for our next song.
Love went first.
please do take a seat. And let me welcome you very warmly. If you have joined us since we started, it's great to join together. And here are a few bits of news and church family information just to help us in the week ahead. The first thing is that next Sunday is our next church lunch. It is catered by our chef Aaron, who is going to make us a curry. And Steve tells me there is a non-curry option as well. And we do need pudding. So if you're able to bring a pudding, please do. Pre-sliced, if it is a cake type of pudding, with the ingredients listed for allergy purposes as well. We will need help with setting up and with clearing up on the day. And actually, it'd be good to have somebody who could be a little bit early, who could be the cake receiver. It doesn't mean you're going to eat all the cakes, but supervise. I wonder if someone would be happy to sort of sit their hand up and come at about 10 o'clock. Barb, would it be 10 o'clock, 10 o'clock? Is someone happy to come in 10 o'clock and supervise the cakes? Is someone happy to do that? Male or female? No? Thank you. Excellent. Thank you. You can decide between you who is Mr. or Mrs. Cake for the day. Thank you. That's great. Then our away day is only a month away and is on Saturday, the 18th of May, and up north in about half an hour's drive away from here, so not far at all. It is free, but you do need to sign up. So if you haven't done that, a reminder to do that and to let us know whether you are coming. Today is your last opportunity to buy a copy of this really excellent book, which I have read, and which is called The Origins of Christchurch Leyton. Do you want to know where the history of our church, the history of our area, and the history of the gospel, most importantly, in this area, as we've sought to proclaim Jesus for the last 140 years? Well, this is the book to get. And if you want a copy, the cost is £15, and you need to speak to Barb. And for those who don't know Barb, can you wave? There we go. For those who do, Barb is still the person to speak to. Mostly that is about embarrassing Barb. But if you would like a copy, please go and speak to her. Well, some very exciting news is that the advert for our women's ministry coordinator role, which is the role that Barb does, is now live. And you can access that online. And so please do pray for that. If you think there is somebody who this would be a good fit for, who you know, and you would like to encourage them to apply, why not send them the link? They might be outside of our church, so why not send them the link? It came round with the weekly email on Friday, if you want to access that. Now, we have now got a little video from Zoe Salkeld, and she's one of our mission partners. She's based in Oxford, and she is going to give us a little tour. So over to Zoe.
Hi, Christchurch Leyton family. I just wanted to say a big thank you for all your support for me for this year. My work at St. Ebbs Headington. I thought I could show you a little bit about what my life looks like, take you on a bit of a tour of the building. So let's go inside. This is the foyer area where everyone enters in. The chairs here are quite new. They're aiming to make the space a bit more friendly for parents with very young children who will often need to come out here during the service. There are some toys over in a chest. We put out some mats. It's a good place to be quiet, but you can still hear the service. Let's keep going. This is the kitchen where I spend quite a lot of my time. I'm in here when I'm serving tea and coffee at various toddler groups during the week. I'm in here often serving tea and coffee at some of the one-off events we have. I'm in here quite a lot on a Monday because I clean the kitchen on a Monday morning. That's my responsibility. And then I spend the afternoon cooking for our student nights. So we have two student Bible study nights here a week. One on Tuesday, run by a group called Friends International, aimed at international students. It's called Explore. And then one on Thursday night called Focus, which is for students as well. I have a training course all day on a Tuesday. So what I normally do is I come in on a Monday afternoon, I cook everything in one big batch and then store it in the fridge. And then it's heated up on the evenings that it's needed. But I spend a lot of my life in here. This is the main hall. It looks a bit empty at the moment, but on a Sunday morning we'll have all of the chairs laid out here. The youth group do that, I don't have to do that. But we do put them away at the end of the Sunday evening because we also use the main hall for Splat, which is our Wednesday morning messy play toddler group, which takes a lot of clearing up. And we use it for our student nights, so we'll have tables out and chairs around the tables for student Bible study nights. The youth group will use this space on a Friday evening, both the youth groups. So yeah, we get to use for a lot of things. Sometimes it's warm, sometimes it's not. Come on outside. This is our outside area. We've got a few fire pits because the Christian Union had an event last night here with some fire pits and marshmallows. This is the clubhouse. This is our temporary solution, slightly permanent. This is where children's church happens on a Sunday. So we have a sort of foyer area. This is where one of the small groups meets after the all together time. And in here, this is where children's church happens. So the children, primary school age children, start in the service and then they leave at a similar point as when people leave in Christchurch. And then we come out here and then we have a talk, an interactive talk from the front on the same passage normally that the adults are doing, which is really fun. Occasionally they're different, but normally they follow the same teaching program as the adults. It'll be fun, interactive, there'll be songs. And then at the end of that, maybe 15 minutes or so, we'll split off into groups which are separated by age. So different years in primary school, we've got reception year ones, years two and three. If I'm out here, I'm normally with the year four and fives in the foyer area, and we've run out of space. So the year sixes meet in our senior minister's house, just down the garden path. Let's keep going. Welcome to the other place you might often find me on a Sunday morning. This is the Scramblers room. So Scramblers is a group that runs for preschool children, so about 18 months to, before they join school. And they will come out again at the same time as the children, and we have a little Bible talk, we have snacks, we normally have a craft. So on the craft wall here you can see some of the crafts that we do with the children during the term. And the Scramblers programme works to a sort of two-year Bible overview. So we go through a children's Bible and we cover the whole story of the Bible every 2 years and just do that on a repeating cycle. It's very chaotic but lots of fun. Sometimes we can have up to about 17, I think, toddlers. And some parents will stay out as well, just in case their toddlers are a bit unsettled. We have another room over there called Mini Scramblers, which is for slightly younger babies. A similar thing happens. They also go through the Bible overview, but it's just a bit quieter and parents often stay with their children then.
Well, hopefully that gives you a little bit of a flavour about what Zoe is up to, what life is like for her. You can see lots of similarities to what we do here as well. And that we'll be praying for her a little bit later in our service. Well, today is, sadly, the last Sunday for Sandra Anthony and Felicia. And so it is their last Sunday with us. They've moved to Harold Wood, where there are really excellent churches, which is great news. I'd like to say thank you, Sandra, and Felicia. Felicia is there, isn't she? She is, yes, I can see her. Very good. Thank you to both for all you have done and all you've meant to our church family over the years. Thank you especially for looking after our coffee rota, making sure that we have people to serve coffee and tea over recent times. And as you stand down, we're thankful to Sarah Bowe. Sarah is sat over there. Sarah is taking over. So if you, from now on, from May onwards, if you've got any questions about tea and coffee, then Sarah is the person to speak to. If you've got general questions about the style of coffee or something like that, I don't think she can promise to give you a personalised cappuccino or something like that, but she is the person to speak to if you've got any questions about the rota. But Sandra and Felicia, we're so grateful for all that you've done and for being part of our church family. We will miss you, and we hope that you'll miss us. We hope that you will visit from time to time if you would like to, and we will wish you well, and we will pray that you settle well into your new church setting. In fact, I'm going to pray for you very shortly, just in a moment, and at the same time pray for our youth and our children as they go to their groups as well. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for Sandra and Felicia. We thank you for all they have meant to us. We thank you for the ways they've served with us. We thank you that they are have been part of our church family for so many years. We thank you above all that they are yours in the Lord Jesus. And we pray for them as they now move to a new church setting, that they will settle and serve and grow there, that you will bless them and use them greatly. Thank you that you have prepared good works in advance for them to walk in, that we can be certain of, and that you are faithful and will bring them home. And we pray also for our children and our youth. We pray for them as they go to their groups, that you would speak to them and convince them more and more about your promises in the Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray all these things. Amen. Well, as they go off to their groups, why don't we say hello? Well, let's draw back together again. Well, we're now going to pray, and Josh is going to come and lead us in our church family prayer. So over to Josh.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reminder that we've had in our service already today, that the Lord Jesus will return. We thank you that as we've been looking through Revelation, as we've been going through that book, we've been able to see in our morning services that ultimately Jesus wins. And with that in mind, Father, we lift to you the darkness and the trouble that is in our world today. We pray about the wars and rumours of wars that we continue to hear of. We pray for mercy for our world. Please would you restrain evil and bring peace to those parts of the world that are experiencing war and great suffering. We particularly pray, Father, for your people, for Christians who live in these places. Please would you help them to stand in your truth and be filled with hope and joy in the Lord Jesus. Please would you help them to faithfully hold out the light of the Lord Jesus to those they live amongst. Thank you that the hope of Jesus is available to all people and overcomes all evil. We pray that these uncertain and unsettling times would cause many to find certain and unbreakable hope in you, Lord Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for Zoe and Ed. We thank you particularly for Zoe's ministry that we've just been hearing about and the opportunities that you've given to her at St. Ebb's Headington. We thank you for the church family there that she's a part of and for all those who worship you there. We thank you for the opportunity you've given to Zoe to serve the church family and community in both practical ways and in teaching. We thank you particularly for the children's work Zoe is able to serve in. And we pray that children and families would be greatly blessed through these ministries and would grow in their faith and fruitfulness. We also thank you for all the students that Zoe serves, both through cooking and sharing her faith and your words with others there. Please would you grant her the privilege of seeing people come to trust you, and we pray for much fruit from these ministries. We also thank you for the opportunities she has to learn and grow in her understanding and gifts. We pray for your blessing on her in this, and we pray for both her and Ed that you would help them to be growing in their love and confidence in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for our church family here, and particularly for Philip and for all those with leadership and teaching responsibility at our church. Please help them and all of us to be growing in our love of Jesus and trusting him as our good shepherd. Please help us to live by the Spirit and to put to death sin. Please help us all to remain in your words and to stand firm in your truth. Please help those who teach to fearlessly teach the true gospel of Jesus. And Father, we particularly lift up to you the PCC meeting tomorrow and pray for your help and guidance there. We pray for all of us that you would help us to share your truth, the good news of the gospel, with our friends, our families, and our parish that we live amongst here. We pray particularly for our upcoming door-to-door outreach in May. Please would you prepare us to fearlessly share Jesus. And please would you prepare people who will be at home and who want to know more about Jesus when they answer the door. Please, would you lead us to those people you've chosen who will trust in Jesus. We thank you that the gospel of Jesus produces great fruit, and we pray that you would send your workers, your people, into the world, your harvest field. We also, Father, lift up to you this morning all those who are unwell, who are mourning, who are anxious, or suffering in other ways. Please would you give them your peace that passes understanding. And please might you alleviate or remove whatever is causing suffering. But even more than that, Father, we pray for them and for all of us that you would help us to know with certainty that the Lord Jesus is coming back. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Josh. Well, our creed, our statement of faith that we're going to say now. Well, we're thinking about the day that Jesus returns. And when he returns, his people will be with him and they will praise him forever. Let's stand for our next song.
Yeah.
Please do take a seat. And as we come to our Bible reading and we look at that together, let's pray that the Lord would help us. Heavenly Father, we think of that day ahead in the future, and we long that you would give us a greater vision of that future as we look at this passage together, that you would strengthen our faith, that you would help us, we pray, to understand the things that you have for us to understand and to take to heart today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, over to Gail for our reading.
Today's reading is from Revelation chapters 6 and chapter 7, and this can be found on page 1237 of the Church Bibles. The seals. I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, "Come." I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. When the Lord opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, "Come." Then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make men slay each other. To him was a given large sword. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come." I looked, and there before me was a black horse. Its rider was holding a pair of scales in its hand. Then I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a day's wages, and three quarts of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil and the wine." When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature say, "Come." I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death, and Hades was following close behind him. They were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine and plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain because the word of God and the testimony they had maintained. They called out in a loud voice, "How long, Sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed as they had been was completed. I watched as he opened the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair, while the moon turned blood red, and the stars in the sky fell to earth as late figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. The sky receded like a scroll, rolling up every mountain and island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth, the princes, the generals, the rich, the mighty, and every slave and every free man hid in caves and among the rocks of the mountains. They called to the mountains and the rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand?" After this, I saw no wind from blowing on the land or on the sea or any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea, "Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God." Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from all tribes of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. From the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. From the tribe of Gad, 12,000. From the tribe of Asher, 12,000. From the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. From the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. From the tribe of Simeon, 12,000. From the tribe of Levi, 12,000. From the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. From the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. From the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. From the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing round the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength to be our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat upon them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to the springs of the living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Gail, for reading. Please do keep that Bible passage open in front of you, and as usual, there is a little outline available. Well, what a picture, what a vision. I wonder if you've ever been and seen a movie in 3D. You get these special 3D glasses. They used to have one lens that was blue and one that was red. Here are the latest day version from IMAX. I went there myself yesterday and picked these up free of charge. These are the 3D glasses of the present. And I remember the first time that I went and saw a film in 3D. For me, it was James Cameron's Avatar film. And the images seemed to pop out. And don't worry, you're not popping out right now with these glasses on. But it felt like you could almost touch the images as they came out from the screen. And you come outside and you're almost blinking and thinking, wow, what have I just seen? And it does feel like with our 3D glasses on, that this passage is a little bit like that. It has that feel to it, and for some it feels like this has the quality of some kind of unreal fantasy. Four angels, described as living creatures, with eyes all around and wings, who reappear and then summon the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And then a picture pans to a gathering of 144,000 people before a lamb. What is going on? Well, you certainly can't say that the Bible is boring. But what if these words are really from God, from our God, to us for our good? And what if these visions are there to help us see more clearly, like wearing special glasses? And these glasses are not there to show us a fantasy, but reality. To show us what is really going on behind the scenes of history and what will be in the future. We're in a new series in Revelation, and the word apocalypse is what the word of Revelation in the original. And on one level, none of what we learn from Revelation is actually brand new. It is predicted in the Old Testament. It is there in Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel. They have similar kinds of visions. And chapter 6, these words here, are in some ways a repeat of what Jesus himself said on earth in Matthew 24 and in Mark 13. But the way it speaks to us and to our hearts, that is the thing that is new. It is these visions that are there to speak to our imaginations and our hearts, to help us understand and imagine our future. And if these images, and it's to imagine these images then, are like these 3D glasses, that will help us see things in brighter color, in technicolor, in 3D, with surround sound, so that we know what it is that we are to live for and who we are to live for. To show us the reality that is behind the scenes, that sometimes in our day-to-day lives, as we're getting on with things, that we don't see and think of and appreciate. Well, that is the claim today. And so with these 3D lenses, we see our future so that along with Jesus, we conquer, we overcome, to the end, we carry on and do not give up. So here, first of all, is what is really going on in our world. First of all, a great turmoil. In chapter 4, verse 1, a door opens in heaven. And we said last week, imagine you're in a stately home, somewhere like Downton Abbey, and we long to look through this door, but we are given access to this door, and we can see through. And we see there our glorious God, who is sat on the throne of the universe. That is the reality that we cannot see without these glasses. And we see our glorious God there, and the cry is, who is worthy? Who is worthy to open the seals and the scroll? And the tearful answer is nobody is, except for one, the Lamb Jesus. And so now, one by one, Jesus opens these seven seals. Imagine them like seven locks on a combination lock. You know, one of those fiddly combination locks? We've got some on our heaters here. Imagine you turn each one and you hear the word click. You hear the sound click, click, click. And bit by bit, we see the reality as each picture builds on the next and reveals to us more and more of what is really going on in our world and in history and will be in the future. And the thing that we see and the thing that we feel is a world in turmoil. Chapter 6, verse 10 tells us how this feels. Verse 10, they called out in a loud voice, how long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? How long? It's a question that maybe we asked a lot in COVID that we seem to have forgotten so quickly. How long do I have to live with this? How long do I have to put up with this? How long is a question we ask with illness? How long is a question we ask when we experience difficulty in life? How long is a question that especially those who suffer with persecution will be asking and do ask? How long is the question that we long to ask when we feel small and a minority and weak and marginalized, as Christians have always done throughout history? And here is why they feel like that. Verse 1. I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a loud voice like thunder, come. I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror, bent on conquest. The first seal unlocks. Click. A white horse with his rider appears. He wears a crown. He carries a bow. He conquers. Nations are suddenly being conquered. The United Nations struggle to be united. At the time the Revelation was written, it was the Roman Empire that was in power, the big superpower dominating, conquering. Nation after nation fell under their power. One empire or one superpower comes, but then it falls, and the Roman Empire fell, and another comes, and then it falls, and someone else conquers, and one country shoots missiles at another, and the other one shoots them back. And They threaten to pull other countries in. And again, this happens throughout history. Then a second seal is unlocked. Click. A red horse, verse 4, with its rider. Then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make men slay each other. To him was given a large sword. Peace is taken away, and there is violence all over the world. And people are allowed to do what they want. And we call ourselves cultured and sophisticated and advanced. And technologically, we feel we are superior to previous generations, and we have better healthcare. But the violence still keeps on coming and happening, with the knife crimes and the domestic violence and the bloodshed. And it goes on, and there is no peace. Then seal number 3. Click. A black horse and rider appears, holding scales, verse 6. Then I heard what sounded like a voice among the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a day's wages, and 3 quarts of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil and the wine. Now, in case like me, you're not up on your quarts. I think quarts in the States, I'm looking at the Palutes, you have quarts, don't you? So you're better placed to explain quarts. Well, I had to look this up. And so basically what this means is the amount of flour that you need to make a loaf of bread. So this is what happens. A day's wages, all it gets you, you've worked all day, is 1 loaf of bread. That is it. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine you go to work on Monday tomorrow, and all you can afford at the end of the day, based on what you've earned, is 1 loaf of bread. That's it. It's not the fancy kind, you know. It's not your kind of sourdough artisan bread. It's just a simple loaf of bread. That is it. Well, this is what has happened, an attack on the economy. And this is what happens in wars, and this is what's happening in Ukraine now, as the farmers can't get their grain out and can't sow their crops so easily. And as the prices go up, and there is hyperinflation, and it's global. Cost of living crisis? Nothing new. Every era has it. And so people struggle to make ends meet. The fourth seal. Click. A pale horse, literally a grey-green horse. Verse 8. I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death, and Hades was following close behind him. They were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine and plague, and by wild beasts of the earth. Death reigns. There are famines, crops fail. We give money to the aid agencies, but they struggle. There are plagues. We thought that was something of the past, but then COVID came, and there always have been. Dangerous animals, whether it's inside or outside the Roman Forum, outside or inside the Colosseum, whether it's nature, which isn't always safe, or beastly humans, death reigns. Now, I've said some of that quite quickly, and maybe that feels a little bit crass to just suddenly list all these things. I'm sorry if that's the case, because it doesn't capture the feeling of it, because it is horrible at times, isn't it, to live in our world. This is the reality, though, isn't it, of our world in turmoil as we know it. And I'm sorry to say that we as believers, and I'm sure you know this and experience this, we do not escape. In fact, sometimes these things are particularly directed at Christians, which is the cry of verse 10. As then the next seal, verse 5, opens, click, verse 10. Let's take it from verse 9. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of God and the testimony they had maintained. Christians slain just for being faithful. The word testimony is the Greek word where we get the word martyr from, and they have been martyred. Open Doors says that last year, I looked this up, just last year, 5,000 Christians were killed worldwide last year, many of those in Nigeria. 15,000 church buildings or church properties were attacked or closed just last year. They didn't do anything out of the ordinary. They didn't do anything awkward or especially difficult. They just believed God's words. They just lived the normal Christian life. That's all they did. They kept being witnesses. They kept sharing about the Lord Jesus, the one that they love, the one they believed in. And this is what happened. And so we and they cry out, "How long, Lord? How long?" Well, that is the cry of a believer. It's not the cry of an atheist, because sadly, if you are an atheist, there is no one to talk to, and there is no one to cry out to. There is no one listening. But Christians can cry this, and we have full permission to do so, to pour out our hearts and souls just like this. Well, what does this teach us? What does this mean for us? Well, first of all, doesn't this make sense of our world? In our day-to-day lives, as we're getting on with things, we're shielded from that in our thoughts. But here is what is going on behind the scenes. This is our experience. This is our news. This is reality. And maybe we think, well, yes, I didn't need actually this vision to know that. I just needed to switch on the TV set or read the internet. But the big thing that this is teaching, the thing that our world and our news do not teach us, is that God is on the throne in charge of this, and so is the Lamb. And that means that I am not in charge of it and don't actually need to be and can't be. Doesn't this show just how little in control we are of our world? People predicted and still predict today that if humanity could one day progress and evolve just enough, with our science and our technology and our knowledge and our education and all of that, if we could do that, we could solve all our problems. Well, we haven't managed it. The horsemen, they ride on through history and in our world. But this isn't here to make us feel anxious, overly anxious. And neither is this like some kind of end times bingo or weather forecast. Then you check the world weather forecast, it tells you there's an X, however many percent, 40% chance of rain or whatever. It tells you that, or like bingo, a bingo game. It's not like that. It's not fear of major war in the Middle East between Israel and Iran. Famine over there in this part of the world. And this over here, well, the end must be on Wednesday. It's not like that. It's not that kind of prediction that we're talking about here. But these are the things that happen in every era of history. And Jesus says this will happen between his death and resurrection and ascension and his return in glory. These are what Jesus in the New Testament calls the birth pains. This is life in the here and now. This is our world in turmoil. But instead of all of that making us worried, it is there to show us that we really can trust our sovereign God. Take a look at verse 10 again. They called out in a loud voice, "How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" And that's clear with the four horsemen as well. For example, in verse 4, the red horse is, we're told, given power. And then we're told the same thing in verse 8. The pale horse is given power. They don't own that power themselves. It's given by God. Now, it's not that God approves of suffering and thinks it's good in and of itself. It is horrific. But he allows this. Sometimes he uses it to bring down proud and arrogant nations and empires like Rome. And he always has. But it is a challenging thought for us, I think, isn't it? When we think of Jesus, what do you think of when you think of Jesus? If you think of Jesus, do you think of Jesus seizing control of history like this? Well, maybe not. Maybe my thoughts are not God's thoughts. But actually, the more we think about it, the more comforting it becomes. It becomes a very comforting thought. Richard Dawkins is a famous atheist, And he says that we are just like, DNA is just blind, and that it neither knows or cares, and we all just simply dance around to its music. And so if you get hurt, well, you were just unlucky. But interestingly, before Easter, he said something very striking in an interview on LBC. He said that he was a cultural Christian. And he thinks that is mostly about being decent. But the horsemen show us that our world is not decent a lot of the time. And when we feel the pain of that, where do you go? Well, being a cultural Christian at that point is just not enough. You need, if it's just biological processes, if it's just chemistry and physics and maths and all that, where do you go? Well, there's nowhere to go. But what if there is somebody who is in charge, who sits on the throne, who is in control of all of this? Well, if there is the Lamb, well, there is someone to go to. And he is the Lamb who was slain. So he knows what it is like. His empathy and his compassion are boundless and endless. The original readers, therefore, of this needed to know this, and so do we. John is passing this on to seven representative churches that stand for all the churches in history, and they were in danger of either growing cold or falling in love with this world, being tempted by the things that this world had to offer, and being tempted, therefore, to not carry on being distinctive, being different, being willing to suffer, but going along with everyone else and everything else. But this lifts the lid on all of that and says, here is our world at its ugliest. Here are the reasons why our world will not deliver and cannot deliver. Here is why it is worth being faithful and trusting our Lord. Here is why it is worth keeping on going just for another week, another day, staying faithful. We have a sovereign Lord. But why does he allow our pain? Why does he allow persecution? How long is the cry of our hearts for ourselves and for others? Well, here's the answer. And we need our 3D glasses once again. Because second, there is a great day. A great day. Verse 11. Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed as they'd been was completed. To bring justice, to bring suffering to an end, means that Jesus needs to return. And the amazing news is that we are the reason that God holds up the end of the world. How long is our cry? And Jesus says, just a little longer, until all of my faithful people, all of them, are home. And then verse 12, the next seal, the sixth seal is open, click. And that day will be so awful, verse 15, that those at the top will try to hide. Kings, leaders, presidents, who seem untouchable, army generals with bombs and bomb shelters, the rich with money to buy their way out of trouble, but also those who call themselves slaves, the employees, and free people, it is truly equal. Everybody, we're told, will try to hide on that day. Most of all, verse 16, they will want to hide from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Does that surprise you? The wrath of Jesus? Yes. This is, verse 17, the great day of wrath. Now, many of these things and these images that we see here, the earthquakes, the darkness and so on, are what Jesus predicted on earth. But now he says it again from heaven and shows us in technicolor what these things will be like. There is a great day coming. And this is exactly what persecuted Christians long for. Justice, rightness, fairness, equal treatment. This is exactly what anyone should want. And it is therefore worth persevering, waiting just a little longer, because it will happen. Many believe that our world is like a circle, the circle of life, that keeps going round and round and round and round. The time goes on and on and on, round and round and round. But we need someone who will break into this circle to change our futures for good. And Jesus will. That is what this is teaching us. Well, we're still wearing our 3D glasses, and there is one more thing for us to see. For those who belong to Jesus, we'll be saved from this, and that's what chapter 7's about. So thirdly, a great gathering. Verse 3 of chapter 7. Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. Then I heard the number of those who were seated, 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel. And then look down to verse 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." This great day will not happen until all of God's people are sealed. Remember the seals on the scroll, like combination locks that only Jesus can open. But now the seal is on us. It is invisible. You cannot see it. But it is no less secure. Seals that cannot be tampered with. Like a lock that is unbreakable. A safe that is uncrackable. A truth that is undeniable. A destiny that is unshakable. A future that is unchangeable. That is what this guarantees for us, for you, if you trusted in Jesus. Because salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb. And here's another great sentence to take to heart. Salvation belongs to our God and to the Lamb. He's got this. He'll do this. And one day all of God's people will be there and they will be gathered. What a wonderful picture this is in chapter 7. 144,000 isn't a magic code to unlock. Now, some cults used to think literally that it was 144,000, but then some of them found their memberships went over 144,000. Whoops! So then they had to slightly revise their thinking on this and their interpretation. Well, we don't need to kind of take this literally. It is symbolic, and it's clear that it is symbolic. And it is clear because the Bible gives us the interpretation for this, that all his people will be saved in the end. How do we know it's symbolic? Well, remember the 24 elders in chapter 4 that we came across last time, 12 for the Old Testament people, 12 for the New Testament people. Well, 144,000 people is a multiple of 12. It is 12 times 12 times 1,000. There we go. Who thought you'd be doing maths on a Sunday morning? Well, that is what this is showing us. It's symbolic. But also, there are some deliberate mistakes in here, in verses 5 to 8, which would be deliberate if you weren't trying to teach something specific, which is the order and the names of the tribes are different to Genesis, deliberately so. Now, John knew the list of all the tribes of Israel by heart. He didn't need to go and see Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat to know the names. He knew it by heart. And Judah here comes first in the list here in chapter 7, even though he wasn't the firstborn. Well, that's because Judah is the tribe from which Jesus came. And Manasseh is, if you like, a half-tribe. He was one of Joseph's sons, and he's mentioned instead of Dan. What's going on here? Well, it is symbolic that all of God's people will be saved, his true people. And it's described as a great multitude as well, so it must be symbolic. Well, who thought that this picture and numbers couldn't be beautiful? Well, they are. Because the point is this, that all of God's people will be saved. How reassuring is that? All his true people, the perfect number of his people, they will all make it. No one will be left behind. No one will miss the train, if you like. No one will get lost along the way. All his true people will be there. And it will be a really, really big number of people. I used to help out with a bilingual summer camp in France. And one of my jobs was to get the British-based kids to France safely. This was my most terrifying job of the year that I had to do. But not because it was difficult to get them on the train in the first place, on the Eurostar, but we had to negotiate the Paris Metro with all of these kids. A lot of them, some spoke basic GCSE French, some of them didn't have as good French. And I kept doing head counts. I kept doing this, one, two, three. I kept counting them all the time. Maybe this is a teacher thing. Teachers, do you do this? Maybe you do. Yes, you do. Good, good. And a friend of mine saw that I was getting a little bit going over the top with the head counts and said, maybe we should do another head count. Oh, yes, yes, we should. One, two, three, four. And I counted them. Well, in eternity, on this day, you do that. One, two, you will lose count. If you're at the Arsenal Stadium or the West Ham Stadium, you will lose count. But this day, even more so, because it will be a multitude of all of God's people perfectly gathered on this future day, a huge gathering bigger than anything you've ever seen before. And we'll all be wearing the same shirts too, special ones that you can't buy online. Verse 15, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They've washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple, and he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. We've come out of everything, out the other side of everything that the four horsemen have thrown at our world. How? Well, our clothes are washed clean by Jesus' blood. I wonder if you ever cut yourself. And maybe some of you blokes have cut yourself shaving or something like that, and you get blood on a white shirt or a white item of clothing. Well, get out the Vanish, and you can get it out. But Jesus' blood is the thing that washes here, in this case. Washes our souls. His blood deals with our biggest failures, our sins, our cold hearts, our mixed desires, so that we get to be in this place day and night. A place where there is God's protection. A place where there is food, verse 16. A place where there is something to drink that is of the living eternal kind. A place where, verse 17, the water flows, but the tears never flow. That is the place. Can you imagine it? That gathering. The hottest ticket on earth today seems to be Taylor Swift era's tour. And many hundreds of people have got scammed trying to buy tickets for that. But better than any of that is this. Welcome to Jesus' great gathering. Welcome to eternity. Will you be there? Well, yes, if you trusted in Jesus. If you haven't, what's stopping you? If you have trusted in Jesus, and if we keep going faithfully to the end, and this whole book is there to encourage us to do that. This is our destiny. This is our future. This is the thing that we can't see here on earth, that the internet won't tell us, that we need our special 3D glasses from God to see, that he has given us here in these words. How long? Well, just a little longer. How long in the context of forever? How big? A multitude. How good, so good. Let's pray. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Heavenly Father, we look forward to this future and we cry out how long, and we long to be there. And so please would you help us to be those who keep going to the end in view of this future. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand and sing our final song. I wonder if you imagine our future. Well, it is described also as like a city, and that's what our last song reminds us of. Let's stand and sing together. final prayer as we stand. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Amen. Please do take a seat.
Unmeasured, vast and free, that knew me from eternity, called me out before my birth to bring you glory on this earth. Grace amazing, pure and deep, that saw me in my misery, took my curse and on my place.
Hosanna sin dubise, you cause the amakosi, gong sin disi wan. Hosanna sin dubise, Hosanna sin dubise, you cause the amakosi, gong sin disi wan.
Who paints the skies? Who paints the skies into glorious day? Only the splendor of Jesus. Who breathes life into fists of clay? Only the splendor of Jesus. Who shapes the valleys and brings the rain? Only the splendor of Jesus. Who makes the desert to live again? Only the splendor of Jesus. Teach every nation, teach every nation His marvelous ways. Each generation shall sing His praise. He is wonderful, He is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship Him, He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in His river of fire.
Yeah, come on.
Who hears the cry of the barren one? Only the mercy of Jesus. Who breaks the curse of the heart of stone? Only the mercy of Jesus. Who stones the prison and sets men free? Yes, only the mercy of Jesus. Purchasing souls for eternity. Only the mercy of Jesus. Teach every nation His marvelous ways. Each generation shall sing His praise. Yeah. He is wonderful, He is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship Him, He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts. Full of tenderness, come and worship Him. He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in His river of fire.
Let's lift our voices and tell Him what we think of our Lord Jesus. He's wonderful. He's wonderful, Lord.
the precious blood and my Jesus' name. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. When the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus shed.
Now
the curse of sin has no hold on me. When the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. Oh, that loving cross, my salvation.
My misery, you took my
Yukosi amakosi, gonsin disi wan. Wazani sindumi se, wazani sindumi se. Yukosi amakosi, gonsin disi wan.
The skies, who paints the skies into glorious day? Only the splendor of Jesus, who breathes his life into fists of clay. Only the splendor of Jesus, who shapes the valleys and brings the rain. Only the splendor of Jesus, who makes the desert to live again. Every nation, teach every nation his marvelous ways. Each generation shall sing his praise. He is wonderful, he is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him. He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in his river of fire.
Yeah, come on.
Who hears the cry of the barren one? Only the mercy of Jesus. Who breaks the curse of the heart of stone? Only the mercy of Jesus. Who storms the prison and sets men free? Yes, only the mercy of Jesus, purchasing souls for eternity. Only the mercy of Jesus. Teach every nation his marvelous way. Shall sing his praise. Yeah. He is wonderful, he is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him. He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts. He is wonderful. He is wonderful. He is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him. He's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in his river of fire.
Let's lift our voices and tell him what we think of our Lord Jesus. He's wonderful. The wonderful Lord.
is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood. And my Jesus paid. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed.